regression with a single regressor, hypothesis tests and confidence interval, Stock and Watson, introduction to econometrics, chapter 5. We have already discussed chapter 4. In this video we are going to discuss sampling distribution of beta 1 hat, standard error of beta 1 hat, how to test hypothesis beta 1 equal to 0, how to construct confidence interval for beta 1, what is interpretation of confidence interval. Second thing which we are going to discuss, regression when x is binary variable, dummy variable. Third thing we'll discuss, that is heteroscedasticity and homoscedasticity. Why should we use heteroscedastic corrected standard errors instead of searching for tests for detection of heteroscedasticity? So I am now going to discuss the procedure for detection of heteroscedasticity by White test, or you name it as Eicher-White test, Brosh-Pagan test, GQ test, or any other test. We are going to use heteroscedastic robust standard errors, whether there is homoscedasticity or there is heteroscedasticity. Why? Please be with me. Efficiency of OLS estimators, Gauss-Markov theorem. Why Gauss-Markov theorem has limited utility, has limited application, is limited in its scope. What is Gauss-Markov theorem? And what are the conditions for Gauss-Markov theorem to be valid, and why it is of limited use? This is main outline of our this lecture. So what we are going to do? Basically, we always have population object of interest, the population from which we get a sample and we infer results from the sample about that population. That is our population object of interest. If those results are valid for other populations, we say that our results are externally valid. If your sample results can be generalized only for the population from which you have taken a sample, then we say that our results are internally valid. So if California school district data for 420 districts is valid for the whole of California, the population object of our interest will say our results are internally valid. If those results are valid for MIT as well, for some Massachusetts, for some other state, some other country, then we'll say it is externally valid. So how to we have already discussed that we have a sample, and on the basis of sample we estimate population parameter. Central limit theorem, when you have large sample, the sampling distribution of the sum or the means, that approaches to normal distribution, even if UI distribution, error distribution, is not normal. And square root of estimated variance of sampling distribution is the standard error. We shall use it in a while. So this is our population regression model. From this we get data on X, student teacher ratio, Y, test score, and we try to measure impact of X on Y. Beta 1 is basically change in X, Y due to change in X, which is called slope coefficient. We don't have beta 1, we get beta 1 hat, that is called estimator. Sampling distribution, we make the following assumptions. Expected value of u given x equal to 0 means x has no information about u. Most of the books have, many textbooks have assumption expected value of u equal to 0. Basically that's the case when x is predetermined, but usually we have x random variable. Result is the same for OLS estimators. You can you can go through econometric analysis by William Green book to verify that whether you have this one or this one, OLS estimator properties remain same. X and Y are IID. Why do we have finite fourth moment? That we have discussed in the previous lecture, that if there is an outlier, OLS estimators are biased. OLS estimators should not be used. So this is what we have already discussed in our chapter 4 video, linear regression with one regressor. Beta 1 hat is normally distributed with mean beta 1, variance sigma square nu over n sigma square the whole square. Nu is equal to xi minus mu x divided ui. So what is hypothesis testing? What we are going to test that beta 1 equal to beta 1 0, or you may say that class size has no effect. That class size has no effect. There is a dispute between educational superintendent and taxpayer. Taxpayer is of the view that class size has no impact. Educational superintendent is of the view that smaller the class size, higher the test score is. No. If this is the true, then you need more teachers, more classrooms, more resources. For more resources, you need to put more, you need to have more taxes. And alternative depends on your critical values depend on whether your alternative is two tail or one tail. This is two tail, not equal to. This is one tail. We are using here one tail hypothesis, that reducing class size improves test score. So we say that class size the effect is basically increasing test class size will reduce test score. So beta 1 is negative. Any test statistics in statistics are here in the econometrics is based on your sample observed value, whether it x bar, hypothesized value, population parameter mu, beta 1 equal to 0 or whatsoever, divided by its standard error of the estimator, so that this is in standard units. This is in standard units. So this is your t statistics. This is your t statistics for beta 1. Standard error we have already discussed, and this is equal to this one in chapter 4. This is x bar is in the and square here, slight misalignment. So standard error of beta 1 hat. Now we'll see whether t falls in critical region or t statistics falls in acceptance region. If it falls in rejection region, we say we reject the null hypothesis in favor of alternative. So why n minus 2 degree of freedom? I have already explained that beta naught and beta 1 are not available, and we use their guess by means of formula. Those are called estimators. Standard is using regression software. That's not our worry. T statistics is equal to fine if your critical value for for large sample, if t is absolute t is less than minus 1.96 or greater than 1.96, we reject the null hypothesis. And p-value, I have already made a video on p-value. P-value is less than 0.5%, we reject the null hypothesis. If p-value is greater than 0.05, we fail to reject the null hypothesis at 5% level of significance. It is not probability of rejecting H naught. It is not probability of making type 1 error. So be careful while interpreting the p-value. What is its correct interpretation? I have already explained. This procedure, so if sample size is large, we assume that beta 1 can be approximately normally distributed. So test score is equal to 698 minus 2.28. This comes out to be test statistics t comes out to be minus 4.38, and our critical value is 2.58 for two-sided null hypothesis. So if it is less than minus 2.58 or it is greater than minus 2.58, we reject the null hypothesis. In this case, we have already one-sided null hypothesis, so critical value will be slightly minus 2.7, like this. So we reject the null hypothesis because our critical value, our test statistics value falls below critical value. So it's we reject the null hypothesis as p-value is less than 0.05. Second thing is confidence interval. So instead of giving a point estimate, in general, we talk about we prefer to talk in terms of confidence interval. What is confidence interval? That if we take 100 samples of size 420, as we have sample of size 420 here, then 95 samples will contain true population parametric value. If we take a sample of size n and we take 100 such samples, then 95 samples will cover the true value of the parameter and 5 samples will not cover. That is confidence interval. So we are, again, this all statement is based on if beta 1 hat is normally distributed. So then we say we are 95% confident that this true population parametric value will be in this interval. If it is in uniform, if the underlying distribution is uniform, then please note down almost 100%, 100% population parameter will fall between plus minus 2 standard deviation. For example, if this is mu or beta 1 and this is 2 standard. So that's why it's important to know what is the underlying distribution. The standard statistical inference we are using throughout the course, throughout this text, is standard normal distribution. If beta 1 hat does not follow standard normal distribution, then you should go for bootstrap sampling or some other procedure. So far, so good. We have confidence interval minus 3.3 to minus 1.26. So it means beta 1 is not 0 because 0 is not covered in this interval. So we reject the null hypothesis. So what is a way to summarize regression? That is test score hat equal to 698 minus 2.28, R square is 0.05, 18.6, standard error of intercept, standard error of the slope coefficient. Why should we not interpret intercept? That I have already explained. This is what is how we report our regression results. This is the strata command. Why should we use robust? Today we will discuss why we are using this robust, whether there is homoscedasticity, whether there is heteroscedasticity. I'll explain in a short while. Be with me. So this is your standard standard way of reporting the results. I'll do it in strata. I have provided R codes for this result output, and I will also repeat it in Jimovi. That's very user friendly for those who are not good in R or in strata. OLS estimators, beta 1 not beta 1 hat, okay, fine. Testing, confidence interval, no. What if X is binary? What do we mean by X is binary? We have class size varying from somewhere 15 to 25. So we say that if class size is less than 20, then this class size is small. If it is greater than 20, class size is large. So we have transformed our continuous variable into a binary regressor. If earnings is a function of beta naught plus beta 1 gender. So if you have male, female, 1, 0, vaccination. If I am getting placebo, you are getting vaccine. Placebo means anything, neutral injection. You are getting vaccination. This is at trial stage. So it means that those who are given vaccination, that is equal to 1. Those are who are given placebo, that is equal to 0. So we'll see that COVID protection is a function of those who are beta naught plus beta 1. Those who are given X is 1, those who are given vaccination, and 0 who are not given vaccination. Beta 1 is slope coefficient, but it's binary, so therefore its interpretation is slightly different. So this is Y is equal to this one, X 0 or X is equal to 1. When x is equal to 1, beta naught this one, and expected value of beta y given x equal to 1 will be equal to beta naught plus beta 1. Expected value of u given x will be equal to 0. So this is the case. And expected value of y given x equal to 0 will be equal to beta naught. So the difference between this one and this one is the effect of treatment, is effect of gender, is effect of small class size, large class. So this is called the difference. Okay, fine. Now we have distributed, we have converted our sample into two parts. One is if class size is less than or equal to 20, class size is greater than 20. So we have regressed test score on student-teacher ratio 7.4D. So if D is equal to 1, it means that small class students have 7.4 scores on average more than large class size, or you can say their score is 657.4. And for small class size, D will be equal to 0, so score is 650. Please, if you have test score here, Y, and you distribute it into two parts, large class size, small class size, you will get the same result. You will apply t-stats, you will get similar results. So why are we running regression? So if you have two variables, it can be summarized through tables, through this t-statistics and all that. But when you have more than two regressor, one regressor, then in multiple regressors, regression is a very handy tool. So that's what we have discussed already, t-statistics and all this. Okay. No, that's very important thing. Heteroscedasticity and homoscedasticity and homoscedasticity, only standard errors. And one more thing after this will be Gauss Markov theorem. What are the consequences of homoscedasticity? What is homoscedasticity? What is its implications for computing standard errors? Homo means same, hetero means different. So homoscedastic the data means that they are identically distributed. If they are taken from normal distribution, all the data, whenever we divide it into two parts, three parts, four parts, this data has more or less same variance as this one, as this one. So this is homoscedastic. We make assumption about ui, ui are homoscedastic. What is heteroscedasticity? For example, if data are normally distributed, but for this data your sample variance is 4, for this data sample variance is 8, for this data sample variance is 2, so it means we don't have identical distribution. What are its implications? Your standard errors will be miscalculated and it will lead to wrong results about null hypothesis rejection or acceptance. So we have already discussed, our assumption is variance of u given x is constant. If it's constant, as in case of two samples, we say pooled standard deviation. Why we use this? Because we assume that variances are equal. But if variances are not equal, then we use a different strategy. So same is the case here. Equal group variance means homoscedasticity. Unequal group variances means heteroscedasticity. If we look here, class size 15, our expected value of u given x equal to 0 in all these three cases. Variance is almost same in all three cases, but in this case, the first assumption, expected value of u given x equal to 0 holds, that mean is 0 given any value of x, but variance here is more than here, than here. So we say that the first assumption is satisfied, but variance of u given x depends on x. As larger the x, greater the variance. From here, you have another graph here that you have years of education and average hourly earning. It's when you have few years of education, you have less variation in earnings. When you have more years of education, you have more variations in earning. So variance of this data with years of education is not the same as this one. And it's obvious, it's obvious that people who are just eight grade pass or sixth grade pass, they will earn very much similar to each other. But people who have 16 years education, they may have very huge variation. Some people may reach at the stage at the level of a CEO of a big firm. Some may be just searching for some normal job. So there are huge variations when your years of education increase. So if we take variance of this data and variance of this data, obviously these variances are not equal. So this data are heteroscedastic. How to deal with heteroscedasticity, that we are going to discuss. This is homoscedastic or heteroscedastic. I am least worried about homoscedastic or heteroscedastic. What we are going to do, we are going to apply a procedure whether data are homoscedastic or heteroscedastic, so that result is on standard errors. And if data are heteroscedastic, that correction will take place. If data are homoscedastic, that data correction will not take place. I am going to explain it in more detail in next couple of slides. So first assumption is expected value of u given x equal to 0, x, y are iid, large outliers are rare. This we have already discussed in chapter 4, linear regression with one regressor. At the moment we are going to say variance of u given x equal to sigma square, that is it's constant. If it's not constant, it varies. So then we say there is heteroscedasticity, and with heteroscedasticity result will not be on biasness, result its effect will be on standard errors. So this is our general formula which we have discussed. If this is sigma square u, it's okay, absolutely no issue. This is sigma power 4, absolutely no issue, you can use it. But if this is okay, for Excel program, you use this formula. If variance is not constant, then you should not give output by using Excel unless you make correction in this formula for heteroscedasticity. This is homoscedastic only standard errors. So, so this is valid only if errors are homoscedastic. But if errors are heteroscedastic, then there will be a correction in this standard error of beta 1 hat calculation formula. And that we say heteroscedastic robust standard errors. So when you will use stata command of regressing a variable on regressor, if you will use robust, and if you don't use robust, there will be same coefficients, but their standard errors will be slightly different, or they will be different by a large magnitude, depending upon if there is heteroscedasticity or there is no heteroscedasticity. So we are not concerned with that homoscedasticity formula is simple, because this is all done with the help of softwares. So whenever we are going to run our regression models for cross-sectional data, we shall use heteroscedastic robust standard errors, whether there is heteroscedasticity or there is homoscedasticity. If there will be homoscedasticity, heteroscedastic robust standard errors and homoscedastic only standard errors will be same. If there will be heteroscedasticity, there will be a correction in standard errors due to heteroscedasticity, and our results will be valid. So what is practical implication? The practical implication that always use heteroscedastic robust standard errors. So whenever you use R, stata, or you should use robust, even in eViews, SPSS, there is always heteroscedastic corrected standard errors. This is built in each software, so you should always check this option irrespective whether data are homoscedastic or data are heteroscedastic. So don't use homoscedastic standard errors, because if homoscedastic standard errors may be too small, and if there is heteroscedasticity, so that will lead to wrong results. So that's why we use robust. If you don't use robust, your results will be different here. This will remain same. This will remain same. So my take is that always use heteroscedastic robust standard errors. What to do in panel data, we'll discuss in later on, and in time series data later on. Bottom line, if errors are either homoscedastic or heteroscedastic, you always use heteroscedastic standard errors. If the errors are heteroscedastic and you are using homoscedastic standard errors, your results will be not correct. But if you are using heteroscedastic robust standard errors and there is no heteroscedasticity, there will be no impact on your results. So therefore, it's fine. So heteroscedasticity impact on OLS estimator is that they become inconsistent. So we leave this. Okay, so now we have two more assumptions. UI is homoscedastic and UI is normally distributed. That's, we have now five assumptions, or you can say four main assumptions. UI is even not normally distributed. We say that for large sample, beta 1 hat is normally distributed. Okay, final part of this lecture, Gauss-Markov theorem. What is Gauss-Markov theorem? Gauss-Markov theorem is that among the class of all linear, first of all, first assumption is linear, second is unbiased, third is that among the class of all linear unbiased estimators, there should be homoscedasticity. Fourth is, okay, now you see, we have many estimators which are biased but have smaller standard errors, smaller variances. In cross-sectional data, in economics data, in social sciences data, we don't have generally homoscedastic data. And there are many estimators which are y is a nonlinear function of variables, so nonlinear function of parameters. So in that case, Gauss-Markov theorem will not be valid. So Gauss-Markov theorem is that among the class of all linear unbiased estimators, when there is no heteroscedasticity, variance of OLS estimator will be least. So far so good. So among all the choices of WI, OLS will have smaller variance of beta 1 hat, but you have couple of conditions on that. And those couple of conditions, the five assumptions which we have already discussed, expected value of U given X, X, Y random, no large outliers are unlikely, variance is constant, and U normally distributed. If that's the case, least square estimators are the best. But if there are outliers, if there are there is heteroscedasticity, if there is nonlinearity, then this is not of much use. So therefore, we say that Gauss-Markov theorem is not that compelling, because condition of homoscedasticity often does not hold. It's a very special case. Result is only for linear estimators. So Gauss-Markov theorem is fine, so far so good, but is not that compelling. And there may be biased, nonlinear, heteroscedastic, and so in that case you may have some other estimators which are more efficient than least square as well. So therefore, Gauss Markov theorem we have discussed here, but probably not very practical. As we have seen hourly earning data, you cannot have Gauss Markov theorem validity. So OLS estimator, as I have discussed in chapter 4, is very sensitive to outliers. We should use median regression. We should use least absolute deviation method. We'll discuss it at some other stage. So whenever there are outliers, please avoid using OLS estimators, or address that outlier by introducing dummy variables or some other means of dealing with outliers, in which quadrant that outlier falls. So those are the things which are beyond this lecture at the moment. So these are the five assumptions which we have already discussed. If all these five assumptions are holding, then beta naught, beta 1 are normally distributed for all n student t distribution with n degree of freedom. The t statistics has a student t distribution, and beta 1 is normally distributed with mean beta 1 and variance this one. But provided you have homoscedastic only variance formula. So that's that our okay. What will be the sample size for central limit theorem to be valid? In general, some people say sample size greater than 30, some people say greater than 50. Anyhow, you can work out that whether distribution is normal or not. Okay, so we are going to summarize our this chapter 5 from Stock and Watson. What is that? What our policy question is, whether class size reduction leads to improvement in test score, dispute between taxpayer and superintendent, whether we should introduce an intervention of reducing class size or not. That is our question. To deal with it, we are regressing test score on student teacher ratio, and we have tested so far test score in the class size reduction by 1 leads to 2.28 unit increase in test score. But there are so many other factors which should be considered before believing these results. So what are those factors? What is omitted variable bias? How to decide whether to include a variable or not in the model? What is multiple linear regression? These will be our concerns in the next lecture. Chapter 6, Introduction to Econometrics, Stock and Watson. You can get maximum out of these videos if and only if you read these chapters from the book. Thank you for watching. Take care.